Let's suppose that you were able every night to dream any dream you wanted to dream. And you would naturally, as you began on this adventure of dreams, you would fulfill all your wishes. You would have every kind of pleasure being conceived. And after several nights, you would say, well, that was pretty great. But now let's have a surprise. Let's have a dream which isn't under control. Well, something is going to happen to me that I don't know what it's going to be. Then you would get more and more adventurous, and you would make further and further out gambles as to what you would dream. Finally, you would dream where you are now.
Isn't can you handle the situation? The question is, can you handle your mind? Can you manage the thoughts and the emotions that are trying to poison your progress? Forget managing the situation. Manage your mind. Manage your mind.
Manage your mind.
Manage your mind.
Manage your mind.
Manage your mind.
We the people.
We're one woman.
We're one can.
We're one man.
The things that make us human.
My name is Marcel La Rasta Banfabila Dizon. And I am free.
I ride that one.
Watch a break.
How can you say break when my heart is breaking?
Breakers break, it's a term.
How long a term?
Crayons paint for life.
So, not that long.
I'll write that one.
See the seal?
It's a boy.
No, it's a creature.
A boy is a creature. He is standing, he's riding his board.
I can't look.
Look. Beauty heals.
I can't watch another boy fall.
It's sport.
No, it's sick. He tries with all his might. He works his pecs in his mom's garage. He pumps iron from a catalog so he can hold up the board. Paddle out, paddle, paddle, paddle. He goes to a beach where he knows no one. He kneels. He bites it. He kneels. He holds it. He stands. He's ready to come to his home beach and ride waves in front of us. In front of girls.
We're not his demographic. We're twice his age.
Gets hard little muscles down his skinny front, saves up for a spring suit. The neoprene binds his biceps and thighs. He powders his body so the little hairs won't stick, so he can zip up a size too small, in armor of latex against the shrivelly cold sea. He dreams of riding water. Now, peak of summer, 31 shades of blue, suit peeled back to show 14 carat skin. He hefts a waxed longboard into the ocean from here to Hawaii. Save for the braces on his teeth, he is a butt-fuckable Hellenic god. He plunges, he paddles, he rides. How does it end, no matter how worthy, how pretty, how ready the boy? I can't look.
Antigone, you're an ass. The coast is soft. The kid can swim. You know this. You're an ass.
Did we have the same brother or not?
Brothers.
One day riding the wet, the next sucked under the ground.
That kid is somebody else.
Same youth rising into my hand.
Keep it to yourself.
Same stubble under my tongue.
Think of the family.
Family, you mean you?
I guess so.
It's terrifying that we're blood. Same brother, same father. Three brothers, if you count our father. Jocasta must have been proud of her kids. Antigone, Ismene, Polynices, Eteocles, Oedipus.
That's the part you could leave out.
Incest is efficient.
That's the kind of sentence you could write down and leave under a rock on a different beach.
Incest, invest. A philosophy. Invest in what you already know.
There once was a girl named Ismene. She had parents and siblings. They were not the same people. She was an exiled princess, surviving a war. Her brothers fought on different sides. That's okay. Family split, and that's okay. The rules changed. The rulers changed. And everyone forgot about Princess Ismene's rotten family. Such that she got a really good job with full benefits, 2-hour lunches in a seaside town, and watched surfers all afternoon. She hired the surfers to do odd jobs for her, washing, walks, or cooking for her. They were little pans called jammers. These jams exposed the hip bones and unlaced below the knee. Ismene was a lucky, lucky princess.
I'm burying our brother.
Make a shrine, it's portable.
No, I want the body.
Show some respect for boundaries.
Boundaries are for cowards.
There's the reason 4 of 6 of us are dead.
I'm crossing back for him.
Not him anymore. It. A body is in it.
Where did the boy go?
Swimming.
I'm sucked down.
Watch your language.
I meant the sea.
He was my brother too.
What color were the surfer boy's jams?
I didn't see.
He was right there. Let's go in.
We're under surveillance. Look, there.
Oh.
See?
Is that the same one?
Sure.
I don't think it's the same.
But you like that one.
Yes.
Enjoy.
I need a fresh beverage. I'd like a little more freedom of motion.
We earn that. When we're really good, we earn that.
I will earn freedom through death.
Here.
You were hoarding this the whole time?
Saving. You first.
Thanks, sis.
Good?
Uh-huh.
What can you see?
Every swell. Every drop. Oh, he sets his face against the waves. He squints. He likes the challenge. He's in crayons.
Good.
He's got a shark's tooth around his neck.
Cute.
No, the spike of it is coated with blood.
You don't like that one?
I want my brother.
Boys spring fresh in the waves every day.
That kid tips over and another pops up. You employ a surfer, he finds a real girlfriend, and a new boy comes to work. I get married, and if after 7 years, or 14, or 21, the guy absconds and keels over, I replace him. An equivalent model, or a full shift, a teenager, a woman, whatever. Birth a kid, Kid Johnson bath, birth another, too late, get one from an economically deprived nation. Helped on a drink, there's free refills. Time to make a new brother. To make a new brother, I'd have to make a new me. We would sit and go. Say Dad locked us out of the house to watch porn. Did that happen? We would reflect and confirm.
He became a traitor. He fought against everything that kept us safe. I loved him too.
Safe.
I loved him.
You have
too.
No loyalty.
I am loyal to change.
You have loyalty. You mean convenience.
Get married.
There's no
my sister?
I don't know. Never lost a sister.
It was an incest boy.
How do you know?
I read the box. I'm older. I could read. I read the box.
We never talk about this stuff. All and Icy's and I talked all night about this stuff.
He bit yourself.
I always thought that there could be anything between us, me and him, but you and me. I never considered that.
I exist. I'm right here, and I've been right here this whole time.
Family? You mean me?
You crashed through barbed wire with a bucket of seawater to slosh over our brother. Who's left behind? Me. We'll go where... Where's your sister? And I could say blood is nothing till I bleed through my syringe. But they won't hold me to you. I'm gonna get married, get pregnant, and name my kids. That's start with O. Peony. I'm gonna make a family tree. It'll be messy. Branches, sort of. Branching into branches instead of dividing into leaves. But that's okay. I'm not ashamed of my past. Okay, I'm ashamed, but I think that when I have kids and a little security, my house is nice, but even since we've been invaded and placed under house arrest, a lot less cozy when I have security regarding this regime. When I line up my offspring with just the initials of those nasty people related to us, I'm gonna feel soon.
I love you, Antigone.
Damn.
I think you're rad. I have a plan for us, Antigone. Creon is my dad. I'm a prince, and I love you. Some qualities I like in a girl are the willingness to argue. See, most girls, they let me win because I'm the guy. And maybe the prince, but even just the guy. Most girls let most guys win. They'll even switch sides, start arguing your side because you were louder, or maybe you scared them, and maybe they fear violence. But it's lame. I hate girls who do that. Who are insipid and weak. Now, I don't think girls should bodybuild or anything, but I believe in the goddess and immortal courage that lies beneath the breasts of many women, especially ones a little older than me. Not too old, not misshapen or flatulent, but a little crinkled at the eye. Like the chest above the top a little. Not leather, just like, yeah, I've seen some sun. I like that. I too have seen sun. I think a woman as bold as you could be a lot of fun. I think we could do things. I'll say more on this subject when we know each other better. I have a plan, Antigone. What I'm going to do is explain to my father the politics of opposition movements, the necessity of preventing martyrdom. You are the ultimate martyr figure, being a girl, or anyway, female, and fighting for something people identify with. Fighting for family, which is a very feminine thing to do. You're fierce, but like, fierce in the spirit of domesticity, which is insanely appealing, not only to women, but to men. And if you hang, I'll guarantee them that there will be seabirds flocking around your 10 toes, and ice on your head, little notes on sticks. Not only your brother's body, but yours will be revered. People will cut threads from your tankini and frame them in their homes. You will be tides if you die. I'll explain this to my dad, and how if instead you love me and I allow you to deal with the corpse, if we make a bridge, not a wall, you know, a bridge between regimes. But Creon is your uncle, I'm your cousin, and I know your family. I mean, that should count for something, right? Anyway, that's in the past. And to me, you're not tainted whatsoever. I think we'd be untainted. Will you marry me, Antigone? Which one is Antigone?
I'm Antigone. I'd love to. We are the storytellers.
We are the storytellers.
We are the storytellers.
Our own story
is a study in contradiction.
A riddle.
We know how the story ends.
You know how the story ends.
How do we find a way for everyone to still be surprised?
Appropriately shocked.
Antigone is going to die.
But tonight, maybe she won't.
Antigone is tomorrow.
She cannot see where the path is headed.
And a fragile conviction leads her down this road.
Too bad it's in the wrong direction.
This is about knowing what's right from a distance.
Antigone doesn't understand about consequences.
She will.
She will.
She will.
She will.
Here, my pigeon. Hot coffee and buttered toast.
I'm not very hungry, nurse.
Oh, I toasted them myself and buttered them just the way you like it.
You're sweet, Nanny. I'll just have a little bit to drink.
Where does it hurt?
Nowhere, Nanny. Warm me up anyway, like you used to when I was sick. Nanny's stronger than fever. Nanny's stronger than nightmares. Stronger than the shadow of the bookcase that sneers at me as it moves hour by hour across the wall. Stronger, somewhere in the night, stronger than night itself. with its crazy silent noises. Nanny's stronger than death. Give me your hand, like you used to do when you sat next to my bed when I was sick.
What's wrong, my little duck?
Nothing, Nanny. I'm just a little young for all of this. You're the only one who can know that.
A little young for what, my sparrow?
For nothing, Nanny. But now you're here. Holding your sweet, wrinkled hand that can save me from anything. Always, I knew it. It will still save me. You're so powerful, Nanny.
What do you want me to do for you, my turtle dove?
Nothing, Nanny. Just your hand like this against my cheek. There. I'm not afraid anymore. Not of cruel ogres. Not of the boogeyman that steals children from their beds. Nanny. You know Ginger, my dog?
Yes.
You have to promise me that you'll never scold her again.
Animals who get everything dirty with their filthy paws should not be allowed in places where people live.
Even if she gets everything dirty, promise me, nurse.
So I have to let him make a mess of everything without saying a word?
Yes, Nanny.
Well, that's a little bit much.
Please, Nanny, I know you like her, with her soft fur and her big brown eyes and her little pink tongue. And I know you secretly like petting her too. You'd be so unhappy if everything were always clean. So I'm asking you, don't scold her, please.
And if she pees on my carpets?
Promise that you won't scold her even then. Please, promise me. Please, Nanny.
You're asking a lot with your whittling. All right, all right. I'll wipe after her without saying a word. You're making an ass out of me.
And then, promise me that you'll talk to her. That you'll talk to her often.
Who does that? Talking to animals?
And specifically, not like you're talking to an animal. Talk to her like she's a real person, like I do.
This time the answer is no. Acting like a fool at my age. Why do you want everyone to talk to her like you do? It's an animal.
For one reason or another, I couldn't talk to her anymore.
Couldn't talk to her anymore? Why not?
And she were too sad. She were always waiting. With her nose under the door like she does when I go out. Maybe better to have her killed, Nanny. Without pain.
Have her killed? My darling, have your dog killed? You've gone crazy this morning.
No, Nanny. Human is coming. I'll leave us alone, nurse. And don't forget what you promised me.
Through the world, ain't the wine, through the Give me my brother's body.
I beg your pardon?
Give me my brother's body.
Remove yourself from my office.
The corpse.
Immediately.
If you do not remove yourself from my office, I will have you forcefully removed.
My brother served in New York's 369th National Guard. He played in the regimental band. He died at Champaign Marne. Please, give me his body.
Mrs.
Antoinette Thebes.
Antoinette.
General.
Carlton.
General Carlton, this schoolboy satchel that was my brother's is empty. This bag to carry his breath, his skin, a bag for bones. Would you like to see the contents of this satchel?
The bag is empty.
Would you like to see?
Antoinette, you are feeling heartache. I know this feeling. I know the black man feels heartache as the white man does. And the woman has the same capacity for compassion and understanding as does the man. My beliefs may not be popular beliefs among my people, but I believe they are just beliefs. And when men of the future observe history, it will stand on the side of clemency and temperance and not of rigor and restraint. And this is why I will give you brief audience and not have you forcefully removed from my office.
My brother's body.
Is unrecovered.
Colored boys got away disappearing.
Pity. True, it is a pity. But, I mean, we couldn't possibly identify. And the expenditures of...
Please, sir. I want to bury something of my brother.
An act of ritual. Important. I understand. Ritualistic acts are important, even if they are based solely on imagination or hopefulness. A belief system that grants peace of mind.
His name, Paul Edward Thebes. He served New York's 369th National Guard Regiment. He died Champaign Marne.
Quite a battle.
Telegram tells me he demonstrated exemplary courage, was wounded, saved a company of white boys, French Award Medal of Honor, have pride. This one, from my other brother, Paul killed, will send home his ribbons and French medal. Pray for us. It never came.
The post can be,
It never came.
We are at war. I sympathize, but... A photograph, perhaps?
General Carlton, I don't come from a family of clerks and stenographers. I come from a family of longshore and laundry workers. We don't got no photographs.
Sorry, I...
Need a medal.
You said yourself the French medal was lost.
From your government. From our government, this government. I need you to give me, you must give me, I need and you must give General Carlton, you will give me a Medal of Honor.
A medal?
For my brother.
Mrs. Thebes, the French may award Croix de Guerre to the blacks, but we do not. Stop.
Squatting in rotten, rat-filled trenches, ears ripped by machine fire, burnt by shells, squalid smell of blood, knee-deep in a wasted land of water.
Stop it.
Rats feeding off the flesh of fresh cadavers, eating the eyes, stealing the sight.
Antoinette?
Guest from
motherland. Antoinette?
Lost a hand in battle.
Antoinette?
Twisted and barbed by wire. Continued to fight.
I offer sincere condolences.
You offer nothing.
Here, Antoinette, you are entirely out of step. I cannot possibly issue a Medal of Honor.
A purple medal. My brother.
Stop it.
My brother.
A purple heart is a medal. An organ.
A heart.
An instrument.
Is a precious medal.
For music.
I cannot possibly
issue
any sort of medallion.
Deliver.
A body.
My brother.
A colored boy.
To me.
Silence! I demand your silence now. I have been kind. I have been more than necessarily kind. Some men of my kind would not be so kind. And I demand your cessation on this matter. I demand you recognize your station and stay in step.
My brother.
My father, a chaplain, died.
My youngest brother, a pilot, died.
My brother.
They cannot deliver a heart or a body or a medallion, and you cannot come into my office. You cannot come a black apparition.
I must bury.
You must.
I must
you
bury.
Must bury a symbol.
My brother's purple heart.
Be okay. It's gonna be just fine.
Himan, stop it. Stop it. Just stop.
I will make everything okay. I promise. I'll take care of you.
It will never be okay, then. This is something you can't fix.
Ismini is right. As long as nobody knows, as long as you haven't told anyone else, they won't believe it's you. Just don't mention it to anyone else. You hear me? I'm with you. We'll get through this together.
I did it alone. I buried him.
Stop saying those words. You are the most important thing in the world to me. I look at you when I see our whole life together, our future, our children. Don't destroy us. Don't destroy our children.
We don't have children. We don't have a future. You should marry Ismini, Amen, or one of the other girls we know. They'll give you fat, healthy children.
I've loved you my entire life. Ever since I married you behind the palace when you were 12 and I was 13. Do you remember? Before everything. Copper wire rings and daisies in your hair.
I want you to go. I want you to leave right now.
I'm a part of you. I always have been. Now let me take care of you, Antigone.
Go away. Leave me alone. Let me handle this myself.
You cannot do this alone. They will kill you, Antigone. I will talk to my father.
It's your father that is the problem.
My father's not your enemy. No, I know. I know. I'll go and unbury his body before someone sees.
Don't go near Polynices.
Do you have any idea what they will do to you? Why? Why did you do it? Do you even have a reason? Just give me some time. Let me try and help you. Please. Please. No. It's all right. I'll take care of you. Please. I can't lose you.
I'm scared. Amen, I'm so scared.
So am I. Now promise me you won't do anything else. Everything's gonna be fine, alright? Okay? Yes?
Yes. Okay.
Many terribly quiet customers, but none more terribly quiet than many.
Blessed be they whose lives do not taste of evil.
His footsteps pass so barbarously soft across the sea.
But if some god shakes your house...
In marble winter, up to the stiff blue waves, and every Tuesday...
Ruin arrives.
Down he groans, the unastonishable earth.
Ruin does not leap.
It comes tolling over the generation.
It comes rolling back the night, salt up from the ocean floor.
All your thrashed coasts groan.
What are you doing? What are you doing?
I have to bury you, Polynices.
I was always your favorite, wasn't I? I took good care of you when you were little.
I remember you picking me up from school when I was about 8.
I was such a good brother.
Walking me home, I remember feeling how lucky I was to have my big, beautiful brother hold my hand in front of all these grown-ups. Later, I realized you were just trying to impress girls. Show them how manly you were. I was a prop. So that you can get more girls.
I wanted to spend time with you, Antigone.
I loved you, Polynices. When I was a little girl, I did.
You never thought about her once in your life. I was the one who took care of her.
And I loved you even more, my sweet Eteocles.
I took care of everyone. I took care of Antigone. I took care of Ismene. I took care of the whole damn city.
Let it go, Eteocles!
Shallow, buried in a shallow grave.
Keep it up, and I'll bury you.
What, you'll bury me? You couldn't if you tried. I'll make you pay for that. You know, when Father went into exile, he told me that I had to be the one to take care of the family, because you couldn't be trusted.
When Father went to exile, he had just gouged out his own eyes.
You couldn't be trusted, little brother. You turned on your country. You turned on your people. You turned on your family.
broke your word to me, Tears. We were supposed to share power, but you had to grab it all for yourself.
I had to stay in power. You were too self-centered to rule.
Come on, brother. Let's settle this once and for all.
What did you do, Antigone?
I buried Polynices. It's finished.
And why did you do that?
So that we could have peace. It's finished.
It has just begun. You have started to see. It's our family's curse. You started to see the truth. You are burning with the truth. You see the truth, and it burns you. God, God, is there a sorrow greater? God, what have you done to me?
Warlike winds may blow, but purest sun still shines through orchards green and bright, through orchards green and bright, with manly arms held high we fight, all hand to hand, for the lasting glory of our only fatherland.
No blood.
What?
One moon, no blood. Do you know what that means?
It'll come tomorrow.
And if not tomorrow? Say something.
Then when will it be plain?
Soon? Sooner. Please, don't.
You know.
Of course I know. I have no husband.
God is merciful, but the law is not.
The law is vile and unforgiving, and I don't respect it.
But it's there. And we women are subjected to the foolishness of men.
What can I do?
We'll say nothing. We'll do nothing. We'll finish what we're doing. We'll make fufu for dinner and we'll forget all this.
Yes, we'll forget. Good.
Does he know?
Yes.
What did he say?
There was no witness to our love. He'll carry no burden.
We'll let him go unpunished.
Have no defense.
Feel this. feel it.
Why?
Feel it.
Why?
This is the stars. Dirty stones from a garden. They'll be large enough to hurt. But not to kill immediately. 100 of them will slowly beat the life from you. Do you understand?
Yes, yes. But I did nothing wrong. Nothing, do you understand? It wasn't wrong, and you will tell my child this. Won't you?
No. No, listen. I'll sell my sewing machine, mother's jewelry. My husband has influences. I'm sure he could persuade them to do something.
Won't be enough. They're old men, so they speak as God. There's no arguing, you know that.
Well, I won't let you die for a man who could give you no dowry.
See, he carried my basket home from the crossroad. This man saw me struggling and carried a mule's load of groundnuts without knowing my name. Asked for nothing, other than I walked by his side. In the marketplace, remembered what I wore on every Friday. Even the pattern of that purple ghillie cut from Mother's wedding shawl. He bought nuts only from me, though you know I overcharge. But he liked the way I roasted them. The salt nice, he say, and he meant it. He's from the village on the riverside of the fork. And you know, I've never been beyond that rotting bantung tree. I told him this. And he described every inch of the road leading to his home. It's that different and that similar to ours. He said I'd see his village as a bride. I'll be carried to his mother's door in a four-door taxi. A taxi with cool air and a radio. I scolded him for making promises to a stranger. Then he propped my basket on his right shoulder without flinching. Let me carry you, he said. You miss, you enjoy the walk home. You see, I walked that road every day, but then I walked it for the first time.
I told you not.
Yes, I know. I shouldn't have let him carry the basket. But how many times have I walked that road alone?
First, what do you remember about your brothers? Two playmates who made fun of you, no doubt, who broke your dolls, always whispering secrets in each other's ears to infuriate you.
They were older.
Later, you must have admired them. With their first suits, their first cigarettes. And then they would go out at night, smelling like men. And then they never noticed you at all.
I was a girl.
You heard the door slamming when they came home. Your mother crying, your father shouting, they're snickering in the hallways. And they walked right past you, snickering and spineless. Smelling of liquor.
Once, I had hidden myself behind the door. It was morning, we had just gotten up, and they were coming home. Polynice saw me behind the door. He was all pale, his eyes shining, so handsome in his evening clothes. He said to me, "Well, what are you doing there?" And he gave me a big paper flower that he had brought back from his evening.
And you kept it, didn't you? And yesterday, before you went out, you opened the drawer where you kept it, and you pulled it out to look at it for a long time to give you courage.
Who told you that?
Oh, poor Antigone. With your paper flower from a nightclub. Do you know who your brother was?
I knew you would say terrible things about him, whoever he was.
A mindless party animal. A vicious, soulless little carnivore who only knows how to drive his cars faster than the rest and spend more money in the bars. Once, when I was there, your father had just refused to pay off one of his huge gambling debts. And his face turned white, and he rose a fist, spitting foul words at your father.
That's not true.
The bastard punched your father right in the face. It was pitiful. Your father was at his desk, his head was in his hands, his nose is bleeding, and he was crying. And leaning against the wall, Polynesi sneered as he lit up a cigarette.
That's not true!
You were 12 years old. You didn't see him for a long time after that. That's true, isn't it?
Yes. That's true.
It was after that fight. Your father didn't want to have him punished, so he left. He enlisted in the Argive army, and from the day he joined the Argives, the manhunt began against your father. One after another, the attacks came, and the assassins we caught always confessed in the end that they had been paid by him. But not only by him. This is what I want you to know. The good brother also tried to have his father assassinated. The loyal prince also decided to sell Thebes to the highest bidder. Isn't it funny? The same reason that Polynices' body is now rotting in the sun. I have proof that Eteocles, sleeping in his marble tomb, was also preparing to commit. It was only by chance that Polynices' plan succeeded first. We're talking about two petty thieves who lied to themselves as well as to us, who slaughtered each other like the cheap hoodlums they were over a division of the spoils. Only I had to make a hero out of one of them. So I had their bodies located out on the battlefield amidst the others, and we found them in each other's arms for the first time in their lives, probably. They were skewered on each other's swords. And then the Argive cavalry had ridden over them, and they were mashed to a pulp in Tigne, unrecognizable. And I had one of the bodies brought in, the less mangled of the two, for my national funeral, and I gave the order to let the other one rot where it was. I don't even know which one is which. And I assure you, I don't care.
Why did you tell me this?
Would it have been better to let you die a victim to that ridiculous story?
Maybe. I believed.
What are you gonna do now?
I'm going to my room.
Don't stay alone. Go see Haman this morning. Have the wedding soon.
Yes.
You have your whole life ahead of you. All this arguing was just a lot of empty talk, I promise. You have the real treasure. You have yourself. Your life.
How is a Greek chorus like a lawyer?
They're both in the business of searching for a precedent.
Locating an analogy.
Locating a prior example.
So as to be able to say, this terrible thing we're witnessing now is not unique.
You know, it happened before.
Or something much like it.
We're not without guidance.
There is a pattern. We can find a historically parallel case.
And file it away under...
Antigone buried alive Friday afternoon.
It's Friday afternoon.
There goes Antigone to be buried alive.
Is there any way...
We can say...
This is normal.
Rational.
Forgivable.
Or even, in the widest definition...
Just...
Here comes Tyrese.
Hail you, King of Thebes. I begin by addressing the wrong person because I'm blind. Is that what you think? Because I'm blind?
What's up, Tiresias?
You're standing on a razor's edge. I hear the birds, they're bebarbarismanized. They're making monster sounds. Fires won't light, the rites go wrong. You know my technologies. You know the failing of the sign is in itself a sign. From you, a sickness. From you, a separation. From you, a surfite comes out upon the city. This pile of rot that was the son of Oedipus, the boy is dead. Stop killing him.
You fake, you profiteer, you entrepreneur. You're too quiet.
Watch out, Creon. Watch out. I see the future plunging toward you, and it contains the corpse of your own son. You've made a structural mistake with life and death, my dear. You put the living underground and kept the dead up here. That is so wrong.
I know. I'm shaking. Tell me.
Come on, get happy. You better chase all your cares away.
It hurts.
Shout hallelujah. Come on, get happy. Get ready for the judgment day.
I come.
Sun is shining. Come on, get happy. The Lord is waiting to take your hand.
This isn't right. We all know this isn't right. Shouldn't we do something?
There's nothing any of us can do. They took her sister away. Period.
They're going to kill her. Antigone's our child in so many ways.
You cannot speak her name without causing trouble for all of us. She is an enemy of the state.
How could she be an enemy of the state? All she wanted was to bury her brother.
What she did was against the law, Creon's law. It is not our place to say what should or shouldn't be the law.
What if Creon made a mistake?
He's the king.
Can't kings make mistakes? I know I would want to bury my brother.
I wanted to bury my husband. It isn't right. You got to bury your son.
She should have gotten him to change law instead of breaking it. She's a member of the royal family. She can do that.
To change the law now, let her out of prison.
It's not that simple. That's not how that works.
Tell me how it works, Agave, from your years of making laws.
Go away. Leave me alone.
I just know it isn't right.
What can I do? What can you do?
The most sensible thing I've ever heard come out of that woman's mouth. What can you do, Militia? What does a cook know about politics?
I can be political. I spit in Creon soup.
You spit in the soup?
I ate that soup for my dinner. You served me that soup.
I didn't spit in your soup. I spit in his soup.
You spit in the soup.
Not the soup. His soup.
I just want to be clear. You spit in the soup.
I don't think I'm going to be able to eat your soup again.
It was a political act.
Expectoration is not a political act. Don't be a fool.
Oh, God. There's that soup you make with those little stringy things in it.
That's egg. That's not spit, that's egg.
Oh, man. I like that soup so much.
I cannot have you spitting in the food in this house. I will not stand for it.
To do something. Okay, I am so angry. I obey the law. I cook. I clean. I grieve. I forget and I serve. All I ask in return is mercy. Okay, I want mercy. A king should be merciful. In the stories we tell the children, the cook goes to the king and begs him to free her child. And he does, or God does. Something happened. Nothing will happen if we just sit here and stay silent.
Before I came to work here, I had a son and daughters. We were so poor. It was a long time ago. They all died a long time ago. No one helped me save them. And I tried, but nothing. It doesn't matter who's on top. Nothing changes for us on the bottom. Leaders? So angry I could rip their skin off with my teeth. We don't get a say in how life goes. Other people, powerful people, do things for people like us, Militia. Do things to us. We just have to survive.
Listen to what we're telling you. Forget. The best way is to forget and obey. Be silent. That's all people like us have to do.
No, that's not all there is. Other people feel like I do.
This is Eurydice's monologue. It's her only speech in the play. You may not know who she is, and that's okay. Like poor Mrs. Ramsay, who died in a bracket of the lighthouse, she's the wife of a man who's would intensify the world of this story. A world sundered by her. I say sundered by her. Girl, the undead, strapped to her back. The state of exception marks, the limit of the law, this violent thing. This fragile thing. Try to unclench, we said. To her. She never did. We got her the bike. We got her the therapist. The poor sad man with his odd ideas. Some days he made us sit on a staircase, all on different steps. Her videotaped us, but when we watched, it was nothing but shadows. Finally, we expelled her. We had to. Using the logic of friend and foe that she denies, but how could she deny the rule to which she is an exception? Is she autoimmune? No, she's not. Have you heard this expression, the nick of time? What is a nick? I asked my son, what is a nick? I asked my son. When the messenger comes, I set him straight. I tell him nobody's missing. We're all here. We're all fine. Why do messengers always exaggerate? Exit Eurydice. Bleeding from all orifices.
My mind is split at this awful sight. I know her. I cannot deny Antigone is here. Alas. The unhappy girl. Her unhappy father's child. But what is the meaning of this? It cannot be you that they bring for breaking the royal law, caught in open shame.
What do you mean, me?
The last human face I shall see. Was it you that arrested me this morning?
Yes, that was me.
You hurt me. There was no need for you to hurt me. Did I act as if I was trying to escape?
Come on now, miss. It was my business to bring you in. I did it.
How old are you?
39.
Have you any children?
Yes. Two.
Do you love your children?
What's that got to do with you?
How long have you been in the guard?
Since the war. I was in the army. Sergeant. Then I joined the guard.
Does one have to have been an army sergeant to be in the guard?
Supposed to be. Either that or on special duty. But when they make you a guard, you lose your stripes.
I see.
Yes, of course, if you're a guard, everybody knows you're something special. They know you're an old NCO. Take pay, for instance. When you're a guard, you get your pay. And on top of that, you get 6 months extra pay to make sure you don't lose anything by not being a sergeant anymore. And of course, you do better than that. You get a house, coal, rations, extras for the wife and kids. If you got two kids, like me, you draw better than a sergeant.
I see.
That's why sergeants now, they don't like guards. Maybe you notice they try to make out that they're better than us? Promotion. That's what it is. In the army, anybody can get promoted. All you need is good conduct. Now in the guard, it's slow. You have to know your business. Like how to make out reports and the like of that. But when you're an NCO in the guard, you got something special that even sergeant majors ain't got. For instance...
Listen.
Yes, miss?
I'm going to die soon.
For instance, people have a lot of respect for guards. They have. A guard may be a soldier, but he's kind of in the civil service too.
Do you think it hurts to die?
How would I know? Of course, if somebody sticks a saber in your guts and turns it around, it hurts.
How are they gonna put me to death?
Well, I'll tell you. I heard the proclamation, all right? Wait a minute. How'd that go? In order that our fair city shall not be polluted with her sinful blood, she shall be murdered. Yeah, that means they shove you in a cave and wall up the cave.
Alive?
Yes.
Oh, tomb. Oh, bridal bed. Oh.
Yes, outside the southeast gate of town in the Cave of Hades. Broad daylight. Some detail. For them, that's on the job. First, they thought maybe it was a job for the army. Now it looks like it's going to be for the guards. there's an outfit for you. Nothing the guard can do. No wonder the army's jealous.
A pair of animals.
What do you mean, a pair of animals?
When the wind blows, all they need to do is press close against one another. I am all alone.
Is there anything you want? I can go get it for you, you know?
You are very kind. Yes, there is something I want. I want you to give someone a letter for me when I am dead.
How's that again? A letter?
Yes. I want to write a letter, and I want you to give it to someone.
Now, wait a minute. Take it easy. It's as much as my job is where to go hang out letters from prisoners.
I'll give you this ring if you'll do it.
Is it gold?
Yes, it is gold.
No can do. Suppose they go through my pockets. I might get 6 months for a thing like that. Listen, I'll tell you what I do. You tell me what you want to say, and I'll write it down in my book. Then afterwards, I'll tear out the pages and give them to the party. See? It's in my handwriting. It's all right.
In your handwriting? No, that would be awful. Poor darling. In your handwriting.
Okay. No skin off my nose.
Of course. I'll keep the ring. But hurry, time is getting short. Where is your notebook? Ready? Right? Now, my darling.
The boyfriend, eh?
My darling, I wanted to die, and perhaps you will not love me anymore.
Will not love me anymore.
Creon was right. It is terrible to die.
Terrible to die.
And I don't even know what I'm dying for. I am afraid.
Wait a minute. How fast do you think I can write?
Where are you?
And I don't even know what I am dying for.
No, scratch that out. Nobody must know that. They have no right to know. It's as if they saw me naked. Touched me after I was dead. Scratch it all out. Just say, forgive me.
Cut it all out? Everything you said there at the end, and I just put down, forgive me?
Yes. Forgive me, my darling. You would have all have been happy. Except for Antigone. I love you.
I love you. Is that all?
That's all.
Damn. Funny letter.
I know.
Who is it to? That's enough out of you. Come on.
She used a belt.
A thin strap.
She hung it from this point right here.
She took the belt from around her waist and tied it around her neck.
Suspended herself from this very point.
She knew what she was doing when she spoke out.
She buried her brother.
That's not technically a crime.
But the governor said it was forbidden.
There are laws
against treason
and betrayal.
She took his corpse.
Went out into the public field.
Buried him.
And spoke over his grave.
And sang a mournful song.
She didn't sing quiet.
She wanted the world to hear.
World? Where are we?
Beyond the world, I assume.
The underworld. Then you followed me here.
It was my destiny.
You could have lived.
I didn't.
I'm sorry.
What for?
Bringing tragedy into your life.
I don't mind tragedy.
I had to do what I did. Something colossal went wrong and it was changing the composition of human decency.
Antigone, you did the right thing.
It was the right thing. I had to be courageous.
You were courageous.
The end was dark and cold. A long time passed. No time at all. Time stopped. I was afraid of death.
Didn't you know that I would follow you?
I was afraid to die.
Now I'm here with you.
Yes. No longer afraid. I didn't expect the underworld to be so serene. Thought I'd see my doomed family.
This may be Bardo, a transition place.
It's rather beautiful.
Reminds me of the ocean. The air is more salty too.
What would you have preferred to this?
Nothing. I prefer you over everything. But if you weren't so enraged about all the injustices in the world, I would have been happy just meditating.
You can't change the world by meditating.
You're wrong.
How?
Too complicated to explain right now.
I think we have a lot of time.
The point is, Antigone, that I knew that fire inside you was irreconcilable. You were born with that fire. I didn't try to change you.
I tried to change you, didn't I? I couldn't find a revolution I could sign us both up for.
So you left.
Yes, I did.
When you were executed,
I hanged myself.
When you hanged yourself, I tried to kill the king. I failed.
Thank you. Following me. I was desperately lonely.
I was keeping my promise. We were engaged.
What now?
We wait.
What are we waiting for?
An opportunity for reincarnation.
Why do you want to go back?
We didn't finish our story.
Will you touch my face? I like it when you touch my face. Will we find each other?
It's our destiny.
Look for me fighting in a revolution.
You should look for me meditating in a monastery.
Did you really try to kill the king?
It was a pathetic attempt. But I spat at him, at least.
We won't remember each other, will we?
Not initially. But before our end, we will fall in love again.
Yes. Yes, I'm no longer afraid.
I follow you.
Creon, king of thieves, most honored in our lands, what horrors remain to be seen and hear, what weight of sorrow are yours to endure? There is more that you will have to bear, more, I can see it. There is more to follow.
This is the price of my son. This is the effect of having no effect until it is too late. Speak up too late. Too late. Too late. I remember what it was like. I want that again. Before the war, before poverty and the loss. When I was young and I believed in so many things, I want that again. Antigone asked me once what I wanted. This is what I want. And since he's gone forever, since all of those things are gone forever, I want my silence forever.
She cuts her own throat with a razor, and she bleeds on her white marble dressing table. And bottles of perfume and powder float in a river of blood. This is what it costs.
This is what it costs.
This is what it costs.
This can't be the end. I was only trying to do what was right.
You were right. Antigone was right. The moment of madness passes. And only then we can see the truth in what we opposed so violently before.
Seen from the vantage point of history, Creon, your great kingdom is gone.
Your once powerful city? Doesn't even have roads leading to it anymore.
It has been erased, like pencil marks fading in an old student's notebook.
Your house
preserve the boy.
Walls that were once heavy and strong have fallen in on themselves, and the heavy stones have crumbled into dust.
Children play among stones, and laugh, and jump, and pretend to be kings and queens while their mothers call to them to come home. To come home, come home.
But Antigone lives on. Her story has been told thousands of times in hundreds of languages. For over 2,000 years, she has lived in stories, in plays, and now again tonight. We're back to where we started. Here is Antigone.
Spot where she waited on that morning after burying her brother.
Here's my sister. She's waiting for you to decide her fate. Here, at the moment where forgiveness is possible.
Then let me do it. Let me forgive her.
No, you can't. This moment has come in the telling of the story hundreds of thousands of times since the first time. The possibility of forgiveness. But she's not yours to forgive.
Then why show her to me then?
I'm not showing her to you. I'm showing her to them. The people. This is why we told the story again. Go on now, Creon. We're going to enter the story now. Wait for it to be told again. And until then, be silent.